central character in this story is loosely inspired by one of the most iconic women in fiction. I'm curious, what is it about that character and about the emotional core of that journey that interested you personally?
I think that what Flaubert managed to do writing Madame Bovary was capture a very average woman that has a sort of extraordinary, in a very sort of provincial way, story. And it's sort of like, she's quite dull actually, and quite nothing special. She's just a young woman that is bored and seeks out romance and drama. And I think that, you know, what he managed to do was capture quite what it is to be a young woman in a very non-romantic way. And so I think it's not just about young women either. It's, you know, young people growing up and going through relationships and them sort of structuring where you are, and then you learn who you are through them. And I think that that's what happens with Gemma for... Absolutely, and in Madame Bovary too.
Talk about the challenges of making a film as beautiful as this, but in French.
Yeah, I didn't speak French before I started the film, so I had to learn it in a very sort of intense and quick way. And now my French is... Now when I see the film, I think, oh, my French is so much better now. But in a way, it was nice that the character of Gemma was learning French as well, and so I was allowed to, in a weird way, we sort of shot it in sequence so that my French would get better. But it is a challenge. I'm in the middle of making a film which is at a much, much, much more advanced level of French speaking at the moment. And you're out of your comfort zone. It's quite weird speaking in a language that isn't your own and emoting through that. But it's a really weirdly satisfying challenge as well. It's like you have a different voice or a different personality comes out. And I think for the character of Gemma, it was quite interesting for her to be sort of these two people in this new place, and she wasn't quite sure who she was at one point. And I was really well supported with Anne Fontaine, who's the director, was so incredibly patient with me and helped me through it, and she understood that it's hard. I'm really proud that I did it.
The film looks sensual on screen, the cinematography, the locations, but also particularly some of your scenes. Can you talk about that aspect of the film, the story?
We wanted the film to be very, very sensual, sensory as well. Gemma arrives in France and takes in the surroundings and the food and the wine and everything and the nature, and it's very sensory. Anne's films always are very, very sensual. She's a woman and she loves that side of, and she wanted it to be very feminine and soft, and so the lighting all reflected that. It all helped with the film, to make the film what it is.
I guess the film starts really with Gemma's character breaking up with the guy that I play, really, and he kind of messed with her life. You know, he was cheating on her, they had something good, and he messed it up. And then she goes on this kind of journey of self-discovery, and then my character comes back into her life and tries to turn things upside down again by saying, you know, I love you and I messed up and please forgive me. But, you know, things have changed, so yeah.
You're working with a beautiful actress in Gemma Arterton. Can you talk about that experience and what you think she specifically brings to that central character?
I think she's such a natural actress. She's a natural person. She's very warm, and you know, there's a sensitivity there as well. You know, she brings a lot of natural detail. Very, very elegant, and she brought a lot of beautiful warmth, I would say. You know. Yeah.
Have you got a specific memory or a specific example of that kind of warmth, that kind of elegance you're talking about?
I guess just the way she is. She's just very natural. You know, she's natural in life, but then she brings that to camera as well, which is, you know, it's a hard thing to do that. France, because it's Normandy, that part of the world is very provincial, and then having kind of the British characters come into that world, it's quite interesting, because the relationship between England and France and all that's in the film. I've got a film being released later this year called Legend, about the craze. I'm in that, and there's a film next year called Disappointments Room. And I've just finished something called Myth of Hopelessness, which is a great little indie film, quite a dark black tale, black comedy about a guy who's a tetraplegic and his carer. So quite a twisted black film, but really beautifully done. So yeah.
Gemma Arterton's character, Gemma Bovary, is at a low point in her life in London. Her self-esteem, which is quite interesting actually, because she's so gorgeous and she's such a lovely person, the character, that her self-esteem is so low. And that's when she meets Charlie, who is, you know, sweet and loving and loyal and dependable, and that's where they meet. And then very quickly she falls in love with him because she's so vulnerable, and then they shoot off to France to try and make a life out there, and the rest is a disaster for Charlie.
You talk about the experience of working with the very painfully beautiful Gemma Arterton.
She is painfully beautiful. We had, I was very lucky. I mean, any man would have done it for nothing, but we spent, you know, 8 weeks in northern France together, and most evenings we went for dinner together, and we ran in the mornings together, and we went through each other's lines together, and, you know, it was a very blessed time. I'm a very lucky lad. Historically, that character, you know, from the Flaubert novel, is not the most likeable of people. But I think Posy's adaptation of that allows her to be much more natural and much more sort of like normal, and therefore a lot more accessible to normal people. And also Gemma, when you cast Gemma as something, you get all that warmth and love for nothing, you know, because it oozes out of her really. So I would like to find someone who didn't fall in love with that character, no matter how undeserving of it she is.
The story is loosely inspired by Flaubert's Madame Bovary. What do you think the modern setting does in terms of changing the context of some of that subtext?
It's a totally different time, you know. I mean, is it Emma Bovary? I think it's Emma Bovary in the novel. I mean, she's in an arranged marriage, and, you know, she's restricted by the conditions of the time. It's a totally different time now. So I think the adaptation, it's more of a loosely based than an adaptation, I would say.
Of course, there's a big sensuality to the look and the feel of the film. Can you talk about working on location and what that adds as a character in the story?
I mean, Anne Fontaine's a proper French director, you know. I mean, what me and Gemma wanted to do was to experience what it was like making movies in France. And Anne Fontaine is exactly that. And it didn't disappoint on any level. You know, it's sensuous. We had loads of time. Shots would start 35 seconds before the dialogue would start. You had the luxury of that. Multiple takes, as many as it took, you know. It was really cool. It was a really good experience for me. Now anything that's a challenge is interesting. I mean, I'm 120 movies into my career, and so if I find something which frightens me, I go for it, because that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking to be pushed, and I'm looking to do something which doesn't involve, you know, going you're a dead man and throwing myself off bridges and, you know, running around with the action adventure guys. You know, it's great to do something that I care about and that pushes me.
What's your next challenge? What are you going on to next?
I've just finished doing a TV show for Fincher, which was lovely, after having done Ben Button with him 10 years ago. We managed to stay mates, which is amazing. And so I've just been in LA, and now I'm home, and I've got my mum here and my wife here. My kids are safely tucked up in bed, and I'll be getting them up for school tomorrow.
Well, is there anything about that series?
Do you know what? It's called Videosyncrasy, and we are on hiatus at the moment. There is issues with the writers. I mean, it'd be great if it works. It'd be great. I'll be chuffed a bit. I mean, we're past the pilot stage, but we're now at episode 5 and on hiatus, which doesn't bode well. But, you know, the glass half full that I always am means I'm home with my wife rather than sitting in a bed sitting Silver Lake.